Good morning. We're going to stand and open up with hymn number 142. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
Please join me in our call to worship and prayer of the day, and this will be read responsively. I will read the parts in light, and you will respond with what is in bold. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The glory of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. To whom will you compare me, says the Holy One? Who is like our God in heaven above or earth below? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall rise up on wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The glory of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Great and wonderful Father, we gather today into your house to give praise, honor, and glory to your wonderful name. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit be with us here in this time. Lord, we pray that Spirit would move among us within our hearts and our minds. Lord, that you would open our minds to your great mysteries, that you would fill our hearts with great courage. But most of all, Lord, I pray that you would remind us today of the great love and affection that you bear for us. And Father, you would help us use our voices to blend them together, to join all of creation to crowning Jesus Christ truly as the Lord of all. Father, we thank you again for this opportunity to be together, and most of all, this opportunity to be with you. May all we do today, Lord, be pleasing in your sight. And all God's people said, amen.
We are going to remain standing and sing Who You Say I Am.
Please be seated. Good morning. It is great to see all of you here in the house of our God and King. On this, the day that the Lord has made, let us truly rejoice and be glad in it. I welcome you all in here in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Whether you're with us in person or whether you're watching us live or watching it recorded a little bit later in the day or the week, we're glad you decided to join us. Now, if you're a visitor here with us or if you've just forgotten, anything you need to know and to follow along with the service is printed right here in the bulletin. And if you're watching, those words that you need to help participate in the service will appear on the screen at the appropriate time. There are a few brief announcements I would like to bring to your attention. First one, this may sound like a stupid question, but did y'all see the sunflowers out there? They were indeed beautiful to come up and to see that nice field of beautiful sunflowers. I've been told by the farmer that planted them, that's a field that we lease out to a local farmer, and he said between now and the next week, this is the peak time of the sunflowers. And of course, the question we get more than anything else is, can I take pictures out there? So I have talked with the farmer, and he did say, yes, you can take pictures out there if you would like to take some pictures. We do ask that you be respectful of that property and the plants there, because this is his living. He makes a living off of this. But there's plenty of space between the rows for you to go out there and take a picture. And also, please do not cut any of the plants. But if you do that, you can go out there and feel free to go out there and take some pictures and take advantage of this peak time that we have. And, of course, the second question I get is, can we hunt dove out there? So I don't know about that one yet. So we're gonna shelve that question for a little bit later. But please, feel free to take some pictures. But please don't trample any of the plants. You might notice Liz is not here, and nor any or most of the youth are gone. They are on their way right now, probably an hour outside of their destination from Woonsocket, Rhode Island. And they are on their annual mission trip to go help build some houses and do some repairs for some needy families and have an opportunity to worship God with one another. So please continue for this next week. Keep the mission trip in your prayers because they are going to need them, especially the four adults that are stuck there with about 15 youth. And actually, they're stuck there with about close to 200 youth now in Woonsocket. But speaking of mission trips, we are planning a Costa Rica mission trip in the summer of 2023. That is a good year from now that we have to prepare and to think about that. But we're going to have an informational meeting about that trip. That's going to be the 31st of July, immediately following worship service. If you're interested in that trip, we ask you to remain behind, and we're going to have an informational meeting. And I want to stress, this does not commit you to anything. If you show up to the meeting, we're not expecting you that you're definitely going to go to Costa Rica. But this is just to get a little more information so you can make a decision on whether or not that you would like to join us. And we ask that all of you prayerfully consider joining us on our trip to Costa Rica. And finally, we are having a special kid-centered worship service on Sunday, the 21st of August, calling it WeKirk. It's for everybody, but it's going to be centered and focused around the kids, and we're actually going to get the kids to help us out for this worship service a little bit. And these Sundays leading up to it, we're going to be preparing it, so we'd love for all the kids to participate. If you got grandkids that you want to come, bring them too. We're going to be practicing on the Sundays leading up to it, but even if they don't get a chance to practice, please have any of the kids you know come because it's something they can pick up real quick. It's going to be a great opportunity to let the worship service be focused on the kids for at least one Sunday. And now I believe that is all the announcements I have at this time. So now I would like to invite the children of the church to come forward and join us here. And also, this time, I would like Bailey, who's normally the sitting back there with the kids, to come join us as well. Give me a statement here. All right, easy question today, all right? Jonah, who this is? Who is this? Bailey. What does Bailey do? She watches you. Make sure you don't get in trouble. Yes. Sometimes a very difficult job. Yep. Is Bailey fun to be around? She has a lot of fun. It would be great if she were here all the time, wouldn't it? Yes, it would. And we really love Bailey, don't we? Yes. Yes. Yep. We love Bailey. Well, guys, I've got some tough news today. Okay. Today is Bailey's last Sunday. She is. Now, she's not disappearing. She's not going to go anywhere. She has just moved on to some bigger and brighter things. Not that it can get any bigger, brighter than y'all. But she has been working this time at going to school for a dental assistant. You know what that is? That's the girl that hurts my teeth, I think. Well, you know, I don't want to help the cleaning and all that, right? Or is that the...
That's the hygienist.
Yes.
I will fix your cavities.
She will fix, when you have cavities,
help fix your cavities,
she will be the one to get the drill up and fix your cavities. So this is the last time you want to see her professionally.
No wonder she had that tooth thing.
Okay. That's right. But today, we are just so thankful. For several years, Bailey has been the shepherd for our kids. She's been sitting with them on this first part of the service, then afterwards taking them back and watching over them, keeping them, helping with the children's church. But for years now, she's been going to school to be a dental assistant, and now she is about to graduate. She's going to take her boards, and unfortunately, this is going to be her last Sunday with us. as the keeper of the children, because I know she's going to be here next Sunday, right, to worship with us. You don't have to answer that. But we just do want to thank her. We want to recognize her. Here's a little gift that we want to give you. And we just want you to know that you will always be in our hearts, and you're going to be so difficult to replace. But we are just so thankful for what you've done for this church, for the value that you've added, and for the way that you've shepherded these children. And I know that you have meant a lot to them. Some have not wanted to come here unless Bailey is here. And so you're going to be tough to replace. But we just thank you. And if we can give her a hand, just and thanks for all that she's done for us. And guys, come here with me. We're going to stand around Bailey. We're going to have a little prayer for her, okay? Good Heavenly Father, Lord, you continually bring people into our lives that just give us so much value and mean so much to us. And Father, we just thank you today for Bailey. And she is one of those people, Lord, that she has brought sunshine to the kids' lives, Lord. She has added so much value to their life and meant so much to us as a congregation and as people. And Lord, as she goes on to this next chapter in her life, Father, we pray a mighty blessing upon her. Lord, we pray that you would guide her, that you would direct her, Lord. You would fill her with your grace and mercy, and that your blessing and favor would always shine upon her. Father, whatever you have coming next for her, Lord, we ask that you would always hold her in the palm of your hand, cover her under the shelter of her wings, and may she always remember the great love and affection that you have for her, and may she always remember, Lord, the good works that she did here at our church here at Cherokee Presbyterian. Lord, we thank you for her again and all that she has meant to us, and pray that all that we do would be to your glory and to the glory of your Son. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, give Bailey a hug. A nice little goodbye hug there. Yes. You know you love her. And now, for the last time, y'all go with Bailey. Go ahead and back to Children's Church.
Thank you.
Thanks again. Mm-hmm. And on the same note, if you know anyone who is looking for a job that only asks you to 2 hours a week on Sunday morning, please let Liz know as soon as you think of somebody. Now, friends, if we say we have no sin, then we deceive ourselves. And we deceive ourselves, and Scripture even says if we claim we have no sin, then we make God out to be a liar. But if we confess our sins, if we are honest with ourselves and our God and come in confession to Him, to lay our sins before Him, our God shows Himself to be merciful and just and kind and forgives us of all of our transgressions. So friends, let us come and confess our sins together, first in quiet reflection in our hearts and to God alone, and then together as it's printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. And now together, generous God, giver of all good things, you have opened your hand and blessed us beyond what we deserve. And though you have reminded us that our provision comes from you, we act as though it is from our hands that we are provided. Out of fear for tomorrow, we store up treasures for ourselves and deny those in need who cry out for help. May we keep always before us the promise that our gifts are from you, and that as you provide for the sparrow, you will provide for us. And as you clothe the lily, you will clothe us, your children. Forgive us, merciful God, and give us hearts as generous as yours, as bounteous as the earth, and as thankful as the sparrow, who gives her song in gratitude to your gifts. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We are now going to stand and sing hymn number 306, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Please be seated. So for this summer, we have been in a series studying the minor prophets. And these minor prophets are only called so because the books they wrote for the Bible are the shorter books, unlike the big one like Isaiah of 66 chapters and so. But today we're looking at the prophet Jonah. And he's a unique prophet because he was a prophet. We hear about him in the book of 2 Kings. But the book of Jonah was not written by Jonah. It was actually written about Jonah. It was about something Jonah did. Now, this is a story we're usually familiar with, but I'm going to give us a little different take on what we usually expect to hear about Jonah. But I'm also going to do the scripture reading a little differently as well, because today I'm going to incorporate the scripture reading into the sermon itself. Because there is so much buildup that needs to go in to introduce the scripture. So instead of doing that, reading the scripture and the sermon, I'm just going to incorporate it into the sermon. So we're not going to read it all at the beginning here. I will have it read out throughout the sermon, and we'll read it that way. You can still follow along with it right here. That's printed in your bulletin. It's going to be Jonah chapter 4, 1 to 11. But we still need a prayer of illumination before we begin. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Good and Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. We thank you for the gift of your revelation, Lord, that you've spoke to the prophets and to the apostles and to the Holy Spirit that speaks to us today. And Father, as we approach your word, Lord, we know we can understand none of these things unless the Spirit that inspired the words would inspire us and teach us today. So we pray that Spirit be upon our hearts and our minds, that you would instruct us, teach us, open us to your word, Lord, to give us hearts that understand and hearts that have the courage to follow your commands. Father, I pray that you bless the holy reading of your holy word, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So when I was, high school, early college, I learned an important lesson from an early mentor of mine. He was a guy named Spencer Parks, and he was the director of a camp I worked at, and he was also a preacher too, and he taught me the important lesson of whatever you preach on, no matter how you feel about it, how strongly you feel about it, how convicted you are that what you're preaching is right, you always need to be ready to accept the consequences for what you say. You need to always be ready to accept the consequences for what you say, because what you say, as true as you might believe it is, may not be so well received by the hearers of your sermon. To give a case in point, he told me about a church he was preaching at as a supply preacher. Now, what a supply preacher does is he goes to little churches who either are in between pastors or they can't afford one, and so they hire one on a Sunday-by-Sunday basis. And he was working as a supply preacher, and he was going to this church, and he had a great relationship with them. They loved him. He loved them. They asked him back almost every Sunday until one Sunday. One Sunday, he said something that they were not happy about at all. This is an old country church down south, talking about early 80s here. And Spencer got up and he preached to them that as much as God loves the Americans, he loves the Soviet Union just as much. Gasp. How dare he? Now, some of you who weren't alive during the Cold War, they don't remember the Cold War, it's kind of hard to think why that was such a big deal. But believe me, it was a big deal. The Soviets were the bad guys. The Soviets were the enemy. Now, it's hard to compare them today because we don't have the same kind of enemy as we did then. I know we still got Russia, and Russia's doing lots of bad stuff these days. But believe me, they're just a shell of their former self. And from what I understand, part of Putin's idea is to get them back to where they were during the height of the Cold War. And I know we got China, but China, we've got a funny relationship with them. They need us, we need them. We don't like each other, but we need each other kind of deal. But no, the Soviets were bad guys. The Soviets were awful. They were the communist regime. They stood against everything we stood for. They stood for everything we stood against. They oppressed their people. Their people had no freedom. It was so bad, you weren't allowed to leave. If you live behind the Iron Curtain and you were caught trying to escape, they would shoot you. We saw videos of people trying to escape the Berlin Wall getting killed. That's how bad they were. And if that wasn't bad enough, they wanted to kill us. They wanted America gone. That was their goal. Have America gone and Soviet Union as the supreme power. And if you don't think that was bad enough, they also hated Jesus. Actually, they hated the church. They were a vehemently atheist regime. I was told a story as a kid about them, and I don't know if it's true or not, but it kind of sets the mood for what we thought about the Soviets then. I was told that in the Soviet Union, every third grader, sometime during his school year, was told by the teacher to bow their heads and pray to God for a piece of candy. And so the kids would close their eyes and bow their head and pray to God for a piece of candy. And after a few minutes, they would open their eyes and look at their desk, and guess what? No candy. And then the teacher would say, "Now I want you to bow your heads and pray to the Soviet Union for a piece of candy." Kids would close their eyes, bow their heads, and as their eyes were closed, the teacher would go around and put a piece of candy on every desk. And so when they opened their eyes, behold, their prayers were answered. All a gift from the Soviet Union. Now this is the enemy. And these are the people Spencer Parks, a friend and mentor, went to a country church, small country church in the South, when the Cold War was its chilliest, and told the people there that God loves the Soviets just as much as he loves the Americans. And it was blasphemy. Because how could God love the freedom-loving Americans, the church-loving, the God-fearing Americans just as much as those godless, awful Soviets? Didn't make sense. Didn't make a slightest bit of sense, and it actually sounded like blasphemy. It's a hard message to hear, that God loves the enemy. And of course, when I say the enemy, what I mean is your enemy. And when I say enemy, too, I'm not meaning just a person you don't like or somebody that you have an occasional rivalry with. An enemy is somebody who stands against us. Someone who stands on the opposite side of us. Think of it, the things that you stand for, the enemy stands against. The things that you stand against, the enemy stands for. And to kind of get some clarity about, if you want to know who your enemy is, the enemy is that person or those people that you think that life will be better if they just weren't there. Now, I'm not saying dead, but just not here. A person or a people, if they just weren't here, either in your life or at your work or at your school, or maybe even in this country, or maybe even not existing. Now, I know all of you, we don't always want to admit that, but we've got somebody that we think that life would be better, America would be better, the church would be better if this people group or this person just wasn't here, or if they were quiet, or if they would just stop being whoever they are. That's the enemy. That is the enemy. And it's always startling to know that that person, the exact opposite of us, that person is as loved, as much loved by God as you are. God loves that enemy just as much as you. This has always been a hard message to bear. Even for God's people, even for people who are trying to be good, it's a hard message to bear. Even the prophets didn't like this message. And the prophets were people picked specifically for their holiness and righteousness that they could deliver God's message. Even they didn't like to hear this message. God loves the enemy. This is what made it so difficult for Jonah to go preach to the Ninevites. Now, normally when we hear the story of Jonah, we hear it as kids. We hear the story of Jonah as kids, and the story we hear is that this story is all about obedience and disobedience. God sent Jonah somewhere, he disobeyed, he got swallowed by a whale, he decided he should obey God, he got spit back up on the beach and decided to obey him, and you know, the pictures are always these cartoon, and there's the whale smiling and Jonah smiling, and it's all just happy and cheery. And unfortunately, we hardly ever read this story as adults and get to look at it through adult eyes. And if you haven't had a chance, you should do it. It's a small book, 4 chapters, just a page in the back of the page. It'll take about 10 minutes. But when we read the story through adult eyes, we find out that the theme really isn't disobedience at all. The theme of the prophet of Jonah is that God loves your enemy. That's the story of Jonah. And that's the theme of the prophet Jonah. God loves your enemy. Now, the book of Jonah begins like we've all heard it. God has a message for Jonah to give to the city of Nineveh. And the message God is giving them is, you're wicked. You've done some evil things. And Nineveh was wicked. They were pagan. They were unjust. They were cruel. They fought each other. They did all kinds of evil things. And God had gotten so fed up with the city of Nineveh, he said, you've got 40 days to turn it around. And so he sent Jonah with that message. Tell them, you have 40 days to turn yourselves around, or I am going to destroy the city of Nineveh. And that's what he told Jonah. Jonah, pick yourself up, go to Nineveh, tell them they've got 40 days to turn their lives around or else I am going to destroy the city. Now, Jonah didn't want to go. Jonah didn't want to send this message to Nineveh. So he did what most people do who were faced with this decision, and he ran away. Jonah took off and he ran away. Now, you might want to ask, why did Jonah not want to just obey God and go to Nineveh with his message? It's not because he was scared of Nineveh. It's not because he was too busy. It was because he hated Nineveh. Jonah hated the Ninevites. They were the enemy. He didn't want them saved. He wanted them destroyed. Now before you judge Jonah, before you're too hard on him, I want to tell you he had good reason for hating Nineveh. He had a very good reason for hating everyone who lived in the city of Nineveh. It's because they were the enemy. And they were the biggest, baddest enemy that Israel had. At this point in history, Nineveh was the capital of the Assyrian Empire. And at this point, the Assyrians were the biggest, baddest dudes on the block. They were the big empire. They had just defeated Egypt in some key battles, so they had become the big player in the Middle East. The Babylonians hadn't risen yet, and so the Assyrians were the big, bad guys on the neighborhood. And they were evil, they were pagan, they were wicked, and they were violent. In the year 722 BC, it was Assyria that invaded Israel. And they went to war with them. And this was a time of, this was total war. There was no Geneva Convention, no rules of warfare. It was absolute warfare. And they sacked the city of Samaria. They burned it. They killed most of the men. The women, they sold into slavery. Everybody else went into exile. It was burning and looting and pillaging. And even children and infants were being killed by the Assyrian army. These are the people that God was sending Jonah to. This was Nineveh, the capital of this evil empire. And he was saying, Jonah, go to them and preach this message of deliverance and salvation. Imagine if, say, the Chinese invaded America. We had this outright China invasion, and our armies were defeated, and there was China here marching down the streets of Lexington. The American flag goes down, Chinese communist flag goes up, they topple our statues, they tear up our constitution, they burn your house, they take your property, all your family is shipped off to a labor camp, and then they cancel college football. I got some of y'all there like, wait a minute, no, whoa. Cancel college football now. But imagine all that happens, and then God comes to you and says, I want you to go to Beijing. I'm angry with Beijing. They've been wicked and they've been evil. I want you to go to Beijing and tell them, if they don't turn around in 40 days, then I'm going to destroy them. What would your reaction be? Great! That's great! Yes! How about this? How about I just not go? They don't get warned, and then you destroy them. Yeah, that sounds like, I like that idea. God says, no, I want to save them. So I want you to go and preach to them this message of deliverance so that I don't have to destroy them. Like, now wait, God, hold on. We can solve so many problems if I just don't deliver this message. America could be free. We could be liberated. Our problems are solved if I just don't go take this message to Beijing. Well, now you know how Jonah felt. Our problems could just be solved if I don't go to Nineveh and preach this message of deliverance. Then God will destroy them and Israel will be free. Problem solved. So Jonah ran. He ran away from God. Not that he was afraid of God, not that he was afraid of Nineveh. He ran because he wanted Nineveh to get what he thought they deserved. We know how the story went. He gets on a boat to go to Tarshish, and as he's out there, a big storm comes up because God has brought this storm because Jonah's fleeing. And the sailors, they try to figure out what God is causing the storm. And they figure out it's because of Jonah's disobedience. So Jonah gets tossed out of the boat into the sea. And as the story goes, it says a big fish swallowed him. It could have been a whale, but the story in the Bible says a giant fish swallowed Jonah. And he was in the belly of the fish for 3 days. And as he's in the belly of the fish, he repents. Says, okay, God, you win. You win. And just as a side note, you can make your life a lot easier if at the beginning you just say, okay, God, you win. And you don't have to get swallowed up by a giant fish. So Jonah goes to Nineveh and he delivers the message that God asked him to deliver. He says, 40 days, unless you repent, the city will be destroyed. And an amazing thing happens, is they believe him. Nineveh believes him, and this wicked enemy city puts on sackcloth and ashes, and they repent of their evil ways. And guess what? God doesn't destroy it. God lets the Ninevites live because they have repented, and it's all because of Jonah. He saved the enemy. Now, as you can imagine, Jonah is not happy about this at all. And it's at this point that we pick up our scripture passage. And chapter 4 begins like this, but it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you were a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to live, to die than to live. And the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? See, Jonah says, look, I knew you would do this. I knew this would happen. That's why I didn't want to go. Because you're merciful and you're kind and compassionate and have steadfast love. And I just knew you were going to show it to the Ninevites. And that's why I didn't want to go. And now I'm mad. In fact, I'm so mad, I could just die right now. And so it picks up here in verse 3. Jonah went out of the city and sat to the east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade till he should see what would become of the city. Now the Lord God appointed a plant and made it come up over Jonah so that it might be a shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plant. So here we go. Jonah's angry, right? He wants the enemy dead. He's really angry about the role that he played in this. So he goes out to pout. He's going to go out to the pout, and he's going to watch the city and see what happens. And it says he built a booth. And this booth is just a little crude shelter made of twigs. And it gives you a little bit of shade, but not a whole lot. And so as he's sitting under this little homemade booth he's under, waiting to see what's going to happen, and he knows Nineveh's going to be saved, and he's kind of angry and resentful already. As he's sitting in here, it said God caused this plant to grow up, this big plant, to come up over the booth and give him shade. And, you know, in the desert, this is before air conditioning, shade is worth gold. And it said Jonah was exceedingly glad because of this plant that shaded him. And then this is what happens. It says, but when dawn came the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God appointed a scorching east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint. And he asked that he might die. And he says, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, do you do well to be angry for the plant? And he said, yes, I do well to be angry. Angry enough to die. So here's Jonah in the shade of this plant, waiting to see Nineveh, if it's going to survive, although he knows it's going to survive. And he's sitting here under the shade of this plant. And then God sends a worm to destroy the plant. So the plant withers up. And Jonah's back there just with his little booth and the hot sun and the scorching wind. And he's so upset he wants to die. And God says, do you do well to be angry about the plant? And it's kind of a question I give to my kids all the time. Because I live with a bunch of teenagers. And teenagers are always melodramatic. They're always reacting way, way beyond what they should. And Liz and I are always asking the kids, says, is this an appropriate reaction? What you're giving us right now, do you think this is an appropriate reaction? And God's asking him that. Is it appropriate for you to be that angry over a plant? Really, Jonah? And Jonah actually says, yes. Yes, it is. In fact, I should be so mad, I should be dead. He's a bit of a drama queen. Yes, he is. But that's how angry he is about this plant. So God says, if you're that mad about this plant, let me ask you this. And these are the last two verses. And the Lord God said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should not I pity Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle? God's saying, look, if you pity this plant, if you valued this plant so much, you didn't plant it, you didn't water it, you didn't work for it, you didn't do anything for this plant. In fact, it was here one day and it was gone the next. If you're that angry about this tiny little plant that meant really nothing to you, how should I feel about these people? How should I feel about this entire city of people, and they don't even know right from wrong, Jonah? If that plant is so valuable to you, what should these people mean to me? Yes, Jonah, I know you might call them enemy, but I planted them. I gave them life. I've cared for them. I've nurtured them. I've watched over them. Should I not love them too? These also, Jonah, are my children. And I desire their good as much as I desire yours. You know, the great Renaissance artist and sculptor Michelangelo was once asked why he always carved and painted people as nude figures. Michelangelo said, I want to see man as God sees man. Of course, people always reminded Michelangelo, but Michelangelo, you're not God. Now, what this story does gives us this amazing revelation and a chance to see our fellow man as God sees our fellow man. And that we are all his children. That God does not see the enemy as the enemy. God doesn't even see wicked people as the enemy. The enemy to God are just children who have yet to find their way home. The enemy are just children who have yet to find their way home. It's human beings that like to divide each other into camps. There's our side, there's the other side, there's us, there's them. It's not a division that God recognizes. And it's hard for us to realize that. It's hard for us to realize that that enemy, that person that stands against us, that opposes us, that we think might make the world better if they just weren't there, that God loves them just as much. That this dividing line, these dividing lines we draw are all just human conventions. You know, Jesus compared himself to Jonah. In the Gospels, we hear Christ saying, just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days, so the Son of Man will be in the belly of the grave for 3 days and rise again. And the comparison doesn't end there. Because just as Jonah brought a message of reconciliation to those that were considered the enemy, so Christ sends the message to the world that gathers all the enemies back into the house of God. Even the Ninevites. Now, we might not have a big enemy today. There is no big bad Soviet Empire anymore. But we all have a Ninevite. We all do. We all have a Ninevite, somebody or some people or some group that stands opposite of us, that stands for what we stand against, that stands against what we stand for. We all have those people that we think life would be better if they weren't there. Who's your Ninevite? Who is that person or group of people that you think would be better if they just went somewhere else? Is it the liberals? Might be the conservatives. Is it white supremacists? Is it the supporters of Black Lives Matter? Is your Ninevite the rich? Is your Ninevite the socialist? Is it the millennials? Is it the boomers? Is it that girl who bullies you? Or the guy that's always making fun of you? Is your Ninevite the teacher who hates you and has got it out for you all the time? Or is it that coworker that's always talking behind your back? Who is your Ninevite? Can you see them as God sees them? Not as an enemy, but as somebody who maybe has not yet found the path home. We like to use the us and them a lot. But maybe the only difference between us and them is that someone showed us the way. And no one has yet taken the time to show them the way, the truth, and the life. It may be the only reason that they are still the enemy is they're waiting for their Jonah. Someone maybe only reluctantly obedient, but someone just obedient enough to give them the incredible message of the good news of Jesus Christ. To God be all the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, will you pray with me? Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe. Father, we thank you for loving us enough that you have not only planted us, but you have fed us, you have watered us, you have breathed into us, Lord, all the nutrition that we need. In our bodies and our minds and our spirits. We thank you, Lord, that you loved us enough that you sent your own Son to die on our behalf so that we who once were enemies are now called your children. And Father, we come to you as human beings with human eyes, and too often, Lord, we look to the other side of the aisle, the other side of the world, the opposite of the spectrum, and all we see are the enemy. All we see are those who stand opposing us, Lord, against us, always frustrating us. But Father, I ask today that you give us eyes to see them as you see them, not as the enemy, but as your children. I pray, Lord, you give us eyes to see all of our fellow human beings as your children. And give us hearts to understand that we also are your children. And just as you loved us enough to die for us, you love them enough to die for them. Pray, Lord, you give us hearts to send that message of salvation, even to those that, Lord, sometimes we despise the most. Pray, Father, that we have that heart of reconciliation, not only in our hearts, but in our homes, in our community, in our nation right now, Lord. That we begin to look around and not see the enemy anymore, but see our brothers and sisters. And to realize we are all created by you, loved by you, and guided by you. And so, Lord, we lift up these prayers to you for a broken and needy world. We pray, Lord, that you would reconcile us into the powers of peace. We pray, Father, that you would watch over and guard us and keep us from harm and from evil. We pray, Lord, that you would bless us and strengthen us, to give us eyes to see truth, hearts that behold the wonder all around us, and souls, Lord, that live in gratitude for every moment that you have given us. Father, we pray today for the mission trip that is in Rhode Island. We pray that you would watch over them and guard them, Lord, that you would surround them with your traveling mercies. We pray a mighty blessing upon their mission, Lord, that they would be edified and that you would be glorified through what they do. We pray for those, Lord, that are sick and need a healing touch today. We pray for Veronica and Mary. We pray for Roberta and Raylan and Georgia and Holly and Bob and Mandy and Carol. And pray your healing power and strength move through them. We pray, Lord, for those who grieve today. And today we remember Lisa and the Moore family. We remember the Porth family. And pray you give them your comfort and peace. Father, we lift up to you also unspoken prayers. And I pray, Lord, that you would hear the cries of the hearts of the people gathered here right now. And we pray all these things in the name of your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, God's message of love and salvation and his desire for love and salvation is so great, it goes out even to the enemy. And this God that has given us so much asks that we give back to him a small portion of the great abundance he has blessed us with to support the work in the ministry of his church. If you would like to support the ministry here at Cherokee Presbyterian, there are many ways that you can give. We have offering plates on either sides of the door as you leave the sanctuary. You can also give through Venmo, PayPal, ACH Bank Draft, or the United States Postal Service. And we thank you for all the ways that you support the work of here at Cherokee Presbyterian. And now in response of thanksgiving to all that God has given us, let us stand and sing together our offertory response. Let us pray. Good and Heavenly Father, we come and we bring these gifts to you here today. And Father, we pray that you would bless both the gift and the giver, and everything that we bring to you would be used for your service, and that they would be used for the advancement of your kingdom until Christ comes to claim it whole again. We ask these things in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And now we're going to continue standing and say what it is we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. And you can find those words printed in your bulletin. Friends, what is it you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We are going to remain standing and sing, O Come to the Altar.
Thank you.
Now, friends, see each other as God sees us, all his children waiting to be gathered into the house of our Father. And now may the Lord bless thee and keep thee. May the Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious to thee. May the Lord lift his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.